A warm greetings to everyone. So this is a procedural video how to manage a condition with ankyloglossia. As we all know, ankyloglossia is a very common condition which we see in children. It gives numerous functional problems which we will be discussing in this session, and we will be discussing how we manage such condition of ankyloglossia with effective surgical approach. So ankyloglossia is also called as tongue tie, which is uncommon, but it's not a congenital abnormality. It is characterized by thick, short lingual frenum, which restricts the movement of the tongue. In the simplest way, Wallace explained this condition as the tip of the tongue cannot be protruded beyond the lower incisors because of the shortened frenum. So these are the problems faced by lingual the ankyloglossia. There are functional difficulties because tongue plays a very important role in mastication and deglutition. It helps the saliva to be mixed with the food and in other masticatory process. So when the movement is restricted, ultimately result in functional difficulty. Next is speech problems. For phonation, tongue plays a very important role, and the movement of the tongue plays a very important role in pronunciation. When the tongue is restricted, again it results in speech difficulties. Next is dental caries. Tongue plays a very important role in self-cleansing activity, that is, removing the debris from the non-accessible area of saliva over the tooth surface. So in these areas, the tongue plays an important role in cleaning the tooth surfaces, indirectly preventing dental caries. Next is appearance. Ethnicity plays a very important role. So when there is tongue tie, it will be not aesthetically pleasing. And again, one more difficulty is during the adult age, it is very important, very, very difficult for us to place dentures, RPDs, or other processes, because this frenum will be a hindrance for all these things. So definitely it has a higher male ratio and has no racial predilection, and it was also found that there is increased incidence of ankyloglossia in infant with the maternal cocaine abuse. So some of the syndromes associated with ankyloglossia are Smith-Lemli-Opitz syndrome, oral facial digital syndrome, Beckwith-Wiedemann syndrome, Simpson-Globe-Mehmel syndrome, X-linked cleft palate syndrome. So before doing definitive management, we should diagnose the condition and we should assess the severity of ankyloglossia. So, Coat-Lowes classification is very important, which is employed to assess the degree of ankyloglossia. It is based on the free tongue attachment length. Clinically, a normal free tongue attachment length will be more than 16 millimeters. But however, when it is reduced, it results in ankyloglossia. So, class 1 is termed as mild ankyloglossia, where there is 12 to 16 millimeter of free tongue. Class 2 is moderate ankyloglossia and only 8 to 11 mm of free tongue is there. Class 3 is severe ankyloglossia when 3 to 7 mm of tongue is only present free tongue. And class 4 is complete ankyloglossia where the free tongue is less than 2 mm. So eventually when you ask for treatment, class 3 and class 4 should be managed surgically. Class 2 is optional. And class 1 can be managed by definite physical exercises. So this is the frenum, which is attached to the tongue and to the lower floor of the mouth and behind the incisor area. So when you come for treatment modality, it is of three types. One is frenotomy, one is next is the frenectomy, then frenuloplasty. In out of all these things, The phrenectomy is the most apt way of managing a condition with ankylosia, because in other two cases there is recurrence and there is not appropriate movement of fungus witnessed. So for in this presentation we are going to see a condition with ankylosia and how we are managing them by a treatment procedure called as phrenectomy. This is a patient with severe ankylosia visited to our department, and the patient is having all the problems mentioned in the above slides. So the patient is not able to move the tongue beyond the lip line, lower lip line, that is evident of restricted tongue motility. A bilingual local anesthesia was given to this child, and two infiltrations were given on both the sides. So correctively, her tongue and the floor of the mouth is completely anesthetized. And to hold the tongue in position and for facilitating us to do the excision, a suture is passed over the dorsal portion of the tongue to hold the tongue in position and to prevent it from falling back. So always try to do a more dorsal approach to hold the tongue. So in this condition, minor arteries is involved, and avoid passing your stabilization of the tongue. The suture should not be passed in the ventral portion, because ventral portion carries many vital structures. So there are different techniques employed. A technique which we employed here is the two artery forceps technique. The frenum that is to be excised on the both margins will be clinched with the artery forceps, and you will be incising the frenum along the inclines of the artery forceps. So it has two advantages. One, there will be no accidental involvement of any vital structures, because you are holding a shield, that is, you are holding the artery forceps along the surface of the vital structures. And next is, in case of uncooperative patient also, this is more favorable, because you stabilized the excision required area, and it's very easy for us to perform. So after doing this, a wedge shaped excision of the frenum will be removed, and after that you should be giving a releasing incision along the floor of the tongue to facilitate the tongue movement. And apart from that, you should also use your suture, that is, you are holding a tongue, right? A suture, you should protrude the tongue, and you should do all movements around the oral cavity, protruding the tongue, facilitating the movement. Ultimately, sutures are placed. When suture to be placed, undermining incision to be given, and suture is placed, should to be placed in the superficial area of the mucosa over the lower border of the tongue. Or you can also leave the tongue to heal by secondary healing, because when inappropriate suture is placed, it can strangulate the salivary duct and causes swelling and other problems. So in this case, we have encased the child to have a secondary healing. And this is how the child improved in a 4-day span. He is able to protrude much better than the last time. In a 1-week span, he is having a much better protrusion of the tongue and a mobility of the tongue. So this is how we obtain a successful treatment result. And the child is also facilitated to do more muscle exercises and tongue movement exercises to facilitate the mobility of tongue in a much higher way. So thank you for your patient listening. I hope this presentation was a little informative for you people to understand. Thank you, one and all.